Good afternoon, everyone. So we are today's last team, and during the course of the workshop, we've explored various aspects of accented speech in the context of voice-driven devices or voice bots. So there's been a lot of progress in speech recognition technology over the last decade, but speech accents pose a very serious challenge for voice-driven agents. And for many of us in the audience who've used a voice bot, you probably share this sentiment. So we'll show you a very short video where popular voice-driven devices are subjected to a number of accents. And this was just from a month back. So these are state-of-the-art systems. And let's look at how these actually perform.
Which rider wrote Westworld?
I thought this number meant for which rider wrote Westworld.
We found it's the T sounds that are missing.
Which writer wrote Westworld?
Which Westworld?
Alexa, which rider wrote Westworld?
I can't find the answer to the question I heard. Sorry, I couldn't find any theater named Rider Road West.
Which rider wrote Westworld?
I can't find the answer to the question I heard.
Let's just try it again and maybe just, like before, maybe just hit the T's really hard.
Which rider wrote Westworld?
Westworld's author.
Okay. So clearly, voice bots still have trouble with speech accents. So this is a huge problem. And conversely, there's also this dual problem that users may have trouble understanding the voice bot's accents. So just because of the mismatch in the speech accents, or users have certain preferences for what accents the voice bots should use. And there's also an intermediate problem, which is of identifying the user's accents from the underlying speech utterance. And this is something that can feed into both of the two problems mentioned above. So we've made progress on all three problems during the course of the workshop. So for the first problem, which is how do you deal with varying speech accents? How does the speech recognition system deal with it? So we've developed some accent adaptation techniques and incorporated them within an automatic speech recognition system. So this was one module that we worked on. We've also explored various aspects of accent perception and accent preference. So how do users perceive accents or strength of accents? Do they understand, how does the understandability of the accents vary, and how does it correlate with their preference for a certain accent, or if it does at all? And there's the intermediate problem, which is of accent identification, and it can feed into either of these two modules. So here's one way in which we could imagine integrating all these three modules. So imagine you have a voice bot like Cortana. So the accent identification module can throw out an endless list of accents that it thinks pertain to the underlying speech utterance, and that could be fed as input to Cortana, and then Cortana can make use of this information to improve its underlying speech recognition system. It can also use this information to decide what accent its bots should use if there is certain preference among the users. So these are the three modules that our team has worked on extensively. So now I'm going to hand over the podium to Aditya, who will talk in detail about the accent identification module.
So when we started working on the accent identification task, we found out that this field hadn't received much attention yet. So there were some techniques like clustering techniques based on Gaussian mixture models and sequence models like hidden Markov models on segment level acoustic features, but the different possibilities in this area had not been explored yet. So we did not have much work to build upon, and the challenge we faced was twofold. So firstly, the thing is that accent information in an utterance is something which is not very trivial. So to extract these, extract the features which capture the accent information was the first challenge. And second challenge was to model these features using a very limited amount of data. The problem is that accent data is accented speech data is not readily available. So thankfully, we had some prior work done in the domain of language identification. And since accent identification and language identification domains are somewhat related, we could take cues from the language identification domain. So one of the features which have been used with success in language identification domain is the I vectors. So I'm going to take a moment to briefly explain what I vectors are, because we are going to use this term again and again in our presentation. So I vectors are basically low dimensional fixed size representation of an utterance, which basically tries to capture different aspects of the utterance. So what we have is, like, we have an existing background model, which is usually a Gaussian mixture model trained on large amount of data. And when we see a new utterance, we try to adapt, we learn a feature which can adapt this background model to the new data we are seeing. Like in this case, we have a two mixture UBM. And when we see the new data, we try to model the shift in the means in terms of our I vector. So this is a low dimensional representation. Now I'll run you through the experiment we conducted to establish the baseline. So we trained a 10 class classifier on the foreign accented English data released by CSLU, and the features we used were I vectors with a Gaussian mixture model, a universal background model. So the numbers we get are not very impressive. Like the nonlinear classifiers tend to work better than the linear classifiers, but nothing very impressive. So like if we compare these numbers with the numbers we have for language identification task, the language identification task has significantly higher numbers. So the data set is almost similar. Like they have a 22 lang corpus for the same CSLU data set collected in a similar manner, and the language identification accuracies are much higher. So one of the problems we might be having here, like we are not fully capturing the accent information present in the data. So we tweaked with the I vector calculation and basically the UBM part. So the problem with the GMM UBM is, like, you see the different mixtures, but those different mixtures, they are not phonetically aware. Like one of the mixtures could have multiple phonemes in them, or they could have just specific pronunciations of one phoneme. So we used DNN posteriors as our universal background model. So this solves the problem. So in this case, we, for one mixture, we have just one phoneme. So this solves the problem of the problem we were having previously, because phonemes are supposed to be important for the accent identification task. And now we can. So basically, we have. So initially, when we were when we had the Gaussian mixture models, so they are unsupervised. So they basically, if you in one of the mixtures, you can have different phonemes. But if you like use posterior, so you have an ASR system.
So they're trained on large amounts of labeled English speech. So these are DNNs which are trained on large amounts of English speech. So the probability of a context-dependent phone. Given your acoustics, so given your features, so the label set consists of these phones within a context, so triphones. So there's a left phone and a right phone and a middle phone. So those are the class labels, and those are the posteriors that he's talking about. So essentially, each of the components in the Gaussian mixture now essentially corresponds to one of these triphones. So now they are phonetically aware, and they're not just learned in an unsupervised manner from the data.
So you can see that we are getting around a 4.5% improvement, which is a bigger improvement on a 10 class classifier. So now at least we have a better representative features which are capturing the accents more in a better manner. So the next thing is that we have to train a classifier. Since we have very limited amount of data, we cannot use data-hungry classifiers like LSTM. So basically, they won't learn much from this limited amount of data. And the problem is that we cannot blame on having low amount of data, because this accented speech data is not readily available, and we don't think it would be available. It would be available in large quantities in coming days too. So. We have to somehow use we thought of using the language I vectors to improve our accent thing. So why we thought it would work is because Language identification, first of all, was giving higher accuracies on the same task, and accent is basically borrowed from the phonemes in the native language. So we tried to use a Siamese network to learn a similarity metric between accent and language vectors and try to convert that into a classifier for our purpose. So what are the Siamese networks? So basically, Siamese networks, and the idea is like we have a twin network and we which have shared weights, and we give different inputs and we calculate the difference between the outputs and keep them as 0 or 1 based on whether they are similar or dissimilar. So in our case, we generated several thousand positive and negative pairs, and at the test time, we were comparing with the representative language vectors and assigning it to the language which the accent was most close. So the performance. Yeah, so X1 is the native language speech I vector, and X2 is the same language. Yeah. So no, some samples are same, some samples are different. So we have positive pairs, we have negative pairs. For positive pairs, the output label is 1, and for the negative pairs, the output label is 0. So.
These are different utterances.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah, so 1 is the native language. So if the speaker.
Native language. So if you're looking at Hindi accented English, then X1 is actually Hindi speech, and X2 are Hindi accented English utterances. So the utterances are different. Yes.
So when we compare the performance of the Siamese network with the already existing classifiers we had, we see a 2% improvement, which was again a good jump considering that all the complex models we had tried earlier didn't work. So the whole idea of connecting the language and accent vectors worked well. And we were able to improve this performance further by using a fusion model, and we are currently at an accuracy of 48.5%. So these numbers seem impressive, and this is some additional analysis on the data. If you look at the confusion matrix, we see that our model was confusing between the geographically close accents. Like we can see there's a lot of confusion between Hindi and Tamil. And if we club these geographically closer accents, we can see that our model goes to 64.8%, while the baseline goes only up to 49.2%. Again, if we consider our second best guess or third best guess, we can achieve results up to 80.4%. So our model, if we consider up to the third possible guess, the accuracy goes up to 80.4%, which is way over the baseline. So the what it shows is that if we do not want very fine distinction between the accents, this model is practically usable. So now I'd like to hand over this thing for accent identification to Abhinav.
So, So let's move to the work we done for accent adaptation. So to start with, let's hear a small clip and let's see whether you guys can identify what the speaker is trying to say in this clip.
I'm a master's student at Michigan State University in materials science.
Yeah, I hope all of you might be able to guess what the speaker was saying, but we fed this same speech to the state-of-the-art speech recognition system, and and this is the result that we got. The state-of-the-art system actually killed the speaker sister, so we actually don't want that. Yeah. So now this is the state-of-the-art performance. So before going, what we actually adapted in our system, we will first see what the state-of-the-art speech recognition system actually is, what's under the hood of that. So basically, it has three modules. The first one is the acoustic model. So the acoustic model actually tells us the phones from the speech. Then comes the pronunciation model. The pronunciation model maps the phones to corresponding words. And then comes the language model, and the language model checks whether the sequence of words that are predicted by the system are correct or not. Okay, so that is the overline. And when we train, when we have trained the system, the decoder actually finds the appropriate output text and gives that as the output. So this is the baseline system. The performance of the ASR system can be improved by modifying any of these models, but we have focused on the acoustic model and adapted it to make it robust to variations in accents. Yeah, so before we move on, let's see what data sets have we used. The first data set is the American English Corpus, which is nearly 250 hours of American accented speech, and it is conversational speech and it is transcribed. Then the second data set we have used is Accented Speech Corpus, which is CSLU data set, and it has 22 accents, but only 8 of those are transcribed, and each accent has around 2 hours of speech, so that we have only 16 hours of transcribed speech, and only that we can use for adapting our system. And we are talking about improving our system, right? So we have to have a evaluation metric. So the evaluation metric for ASR task is word error rate. So word error rate is basically an edit distance between the original transcript and the transcript that we have decoded from our system. So we just calculate the edit distance between those. Yeah, so the speech that I have just shown you was just one of the several problematic speech that we had. So we used a lot of speech to train the models, the acoustic models. So we tried the deep neural networks, we tried the time delay neural networks, and we try LSTMs as the acoustic models. So these models were trained on American accent and were tested on 3 of these test sets. So the first is American accented, then the second is Czech, and the third is Hindi. So we can clearly see that when trained on American accent and tested on American accent, that the result is quite good. Okay. And when the same setup is used on a different accent, the WER increases drastically. So it doesn't know how to decode an accented speech. It can't recognize the phones, we can say. Yeah, so the problem is pretty clear. And in our experiments, we are actually using TDNNs, because as these models take a lot of time to train, okay? So TDNNs also take a lot of time. We could have also used LSTMs, but LSTMs are even more computationally extensive. So we will focus on TDNNs on our experiments throughout. Yeah, so the problem is real and we need to tackle it. Now, so how do we tackle it? We have used 2 techniques. The first is mixture of accents, and the second is using fast training for adapting a already trained model. So we will go into these as we move along. So the first is using a mixture of accents for model adaptation. Yeah, so the standard idea is to train the acoustic model on the American accent. Now in this technique, we train the acoustic model with a mixture of all the accents that we have. So what we have was American accented speech. Along with that, we had 6 accented English speeches, accented speech. So we mixed all of the data and we trained the acoustic model on that data. Okay, and we can clearly see the improvements in all of the test sets we had. So these are the baselines that we had when the acoustic model was just trained on the American accent. And when we trained with the mixture of accents, the WERs have reduced drastically. So I would like to focus on this number actually. So the model is trained on American English accent, and it tested on American English, and 11.6 WER is actually a pretty good number. And we have got the WER reduced by almost 2%. So that is actually statistically very significant in this case. So yes, and the WERs have also decreased for accented speech also. So I would like to focus a point here that training each individual model actually takes 48 hours of time. So that is 2 days. And in a small time frame that we had, 2 days is a lot of time to train a single model. So we moved to fast training, so fast adaptation actually. So the main idea of this model is we start with an already trained acoustic model. So that will be the acoustic model trained on the American accented speech. And then we adapt that model to some accented English speech. Okay, so adaptation is modifying some specific components of the network. So specific, saying last 2 layers of the network or last layer of the network. So we adapt the weights of that network and see how that performs. So this is the baseline. And when we use this setup, the WERs are actually better than the previous experiment. So for Czech accented, we have from 51 to 38, and for Hindi accented, we have 59 to 43. So again, the time comparison between the last technique and this technique is, this technique actually takes just 2 hours to train. So this is actually faster and it performs better on the target accented language. Yeah, so after getting these good results, we actually tried to focus on how many accents is good and what subset of accents should we use to adapt the model. So we did extensive experimentation on this setup. So this graph actually compiles all the results that we have. So on the x-axis, we have the number of accents, and on the y-axis, we have the WER that we got when we trained on these number of accents. So the blue line shows testing on CSLU Hindi, and the orange line shows testing on CSLU Czech. So we can see the first bar that if we don't adapt the model, the WER on Hindi is around 60%, and adding just one accent, the WER reduces to around 48. So that is a huge change. And when we keep on adding accents, so the WER improves, but at certain point it plateaus out. So we can actually confirm that adding more accents than 6 will not help our model much, but adding some of the accents to the original American accent will help in our accent adaptation. So this is the relative reduction that we got. The final was 26% relative reduction in case of Hindi accented speech.
So can you just add some intuition here? Why would adding a different accent give you this kind? And is there a particular accent that we would expect would do better?
Yeah, so actually, yeah, we have experimented a lot on this. So I have a slide on all the experiments, so I will show that to you later. The result is that the accents are variations in phones, actually. So if we have trained only on just one American accent, so it has not seen the phones from the accented speech. So if we modify the model based on any accent, so there is a, you can say, generalization of the model. So that helps to, you know, predict the phones better, and the overall performance of the system improves. So we have actually used various subsets of accents. We have 6 accents, and we use subsets of all of those. We use accents based on demography, whether the relation between the target accent and whatever we are using for adapting have any relation or not. I can show you the slides at the end. Yeah, so.
So just one note here. So we did expect adding some accented speech to help with this kind of regularization or helping to generalize to other data, but we didn't know to the extent to which it would help. So it was nice to see that it did help very significantly with just adding one accent. And more interestingly, like Abhinav said, it even helps on training and testing on the same accent. Even there, it significantly helps. Yeah, that was a very interesting.
Yeah, so we actually don't need the accents for the target language. We can have any accented data, and the system performs very well on any other accent.
But is the goal also to get accents that are as far from the baseline as possible? I mean, or there's also a magnitude of accent. You have a soft accent or a very heavy accent. Is the goal to get the most heavy accent and the most different than the base language, or just a diversity of accents?
So we had only six accents of American, 6 accents of English. So we tried on those, and we saw that if the accent is close to the target accent, then also the WER improves. And if the target accent is very far away, like not related to the original target accent, then also the performance improves. So we can say that any accent helps.
So the accented speech data, it contains varying strengths of the accent. So that's kind of addressing your question.
Sure. But I just think if you're trying to add a new language, what is the objective? To find the most different language, or the most different accent, or the most accented person, or it's just having the variety of the language?
Right. So I think we couldn't do very extensive experiments because we only had 6 other accents. Okay. But we did kind of an ablation analysis on those 6. Mm-hmm. And there, it didn't matter which accented speech we actually,
any
additional one gave us a significant improvement.
So is there any inherent lawyer bond on the amount of WER you will be able to get?
Sorry?
Right now you have got 26.
Lower bound is probably the American accent.
Pardon?
Yes. Lower bound is probably like similar kind of speech, so maybe 10% is basically the best we could.
10%.
Yes. 10 or 11% is the state of the art for this task. So we are a little bit far away from like 30, we are now about 30-35%.
Yes.
It is far away from the 10%.
I'm also interested in whether there is a theoretical lawyer bound.
Yes. Okay. That's an excellent question. So actually, I don't think there's any work which talks about this law. That would be very interesting to analyze. Yeah.
And the other side people talk about is the human error rate. The human error rate is about 5% on this kind. So they keep saying that we have moved closer and closer. All the people like Microsoft and IBM, they keep publishing papers saying we are getting closer. In some tasks, beat human performance. So the human is somehow considered as the magic number.
How much of this do you think data will solve? I mean, simply if you threw more data, would you, like, is that all that you
yes.
really need actually? In this?
Some of
yeah.
it, yes.
You,
some
you,
of it, yes.
Yeah.
Like, the data will help in, because that is what a lot of these companies are trying to do, is to collect more data from the target accent.
Can you take the 30 to 10 by just throwing more data?
Yes. So, for instance, Google has Indian accented bots, Cortana does as well. And they've just trained their models on hundreds of hours of Indian accented speech. But that's not a very scalable model. And so what we wanted to explore was, if you have existing models which are already trained, very well trained on lots of speech, then what is kind of the minimum amount of effort we could kind of put into the model so you can adapt it to the accent, and then how far can we push that? There again, the lower bound comes into play. But
can I intervene here and say it's not hundreds of hours of data, it's tens of
thousands. Yes, it's tens of thousands. Thanks,
Kalka. The amount of data that is required is not trivial. So then, when you say that just throw more data, that more data is several orders of magnitude more than what they're working with.
We are actually working with just 16 hours of accented data, so that is nowhere near what we want.
So the human parity thing is trained, the one that the system that claims to beat the or is as good as the human is trained on nearly 90 to 100,000 hours of data. So you
I'm
can
sure how important it is to even generate these data sets for Indian
languages.
Yes. Large volumes of data sets. In some sense, we like
how
need an effort to. No, it needs
effort.
We need somebody to step
yes.
up.
I mean,
yes.
and
yes.
your company yes. will, you know. Also have a lot to say about that. I mean, people in this country have been trying that for decades and it still hasn't happened. We still haven't reached the point where we have 1,000 hours of data, let alone like 90,000, 100,000 hours of data. So that's where this really becomes.
But that's about public data. Companies might still have, like Google could have lots of Indian
languages. I don't want this to have
But they certainly have more than 1,000 hours.
No, these days it need more than 1,000 hours of data to make a commercially viable.
I think voice will really break the barrier of people to use technology devices
yes.
in
yeah.
India and stuff. And so it's really so important to
where this accent
will be. Okay, so let's move on. Yeah, so after adapting our system, we fed the same speech to our system and the output was, you can see, very much better than what we had earlier. So yeah, we can say that the adapted model actually performs better than the original model. So for the next module, I would like to call Sakshi to carry on.
Thanks, Abhinav. Can you hear me? So hi everyone. So, be it an embodied or a disembodied robot, voice is one of the very important factors for a successful interaction. By voice here, I mean accent, not the quality of the voice or the intonation or prosody. I mean accent.
Unmute, sorry.
So.
It just happened.
Is that okay? Sorry. So yeah, so one line of research says that accent is a very important factor in the acceptance or rejection of a voice, be it a synthetic or a natural voice. Another line of research says that users prefer a voice or an accent that is familiar to them or that is very close to theirs. Such research has inspired us to conduct our user studies to find out the Indian English accent preferences of the Indian users. And as far as we know, this is a first step of its kind in the Indian context. So I'll take you through the first part of the study, the first study actually. We wanted to understand the accent preferences of Indian users between Indian and foreign accents and between two very different Indian accents. We had two hypotheses. The null hypothesis that users would have no preference, and our hypothesis, which is in line with prior work, that users prefer an accent which is familiar to them or which is very close to theirs. Data. So we also use the CSLU data, which Aditya and Abhinav have used for their work. It has foreign accented English of about 22 languages. We picked four languages, two foreign, two Indian. The two foreign languages are Czech and Korean. We picked these languages because they do not really have any aspirational value attached to them. And we picked Hindi and Tamil as they are two very different languages phonologically and phonetically. This data is annotated on a scale of four, or on a 4-point scale, one being the mildest, mild accent, and four being the heaviest accent. And for us, we considered one and two as the mild, three and four as the heavy, and we picked all the four languages according to these heavy and mild ratings. We controlled for content, quality, and duration. So we finally 15 users took this survey. There were 12 males, 3 females. The age group was 20 to 38 years. They are presently residing in Bangalore. They have studied English since primary school, and they have different language backgrounds. What did we do? So we asked each of the user to answer 10 questions. Each question had a pair of audio clips. I'll show you the snapshot of what we did. So we told them beforehand that they would be able to hear each audio clip only once. And also that at the end of every question, they had to give their preference of the accent. So they had to be attentive. So after listening to the clip, they had to rate each audio on a scale of 0 to 100 on understandability. And then they had to choose their preferred accent. Accent preference is a very vague phrase, so what we actually asked them is, indicate which of these two accents you would prefer for your digital assistant, like Cortana. So this they had to do for 10 questions. Before this survey, they filled up a very detailed user profile form, and after the survey, we conducted very detailed participant interviews. So we move on to the results. These are the quantitative results for Indian versus foreign accent, Indian being Hindi, Tamil, foreign being Czech and Korean. This first set is for the heavy Indian and heavy foreign accents. So as you can see, there's a clear difference between the understandability. The users could easily understand the heavy Indian accent over heavy foreign accent. And this has a correlation with preference. Higher the understandability, higher the preference of the accent. Moving on to the mild accents. Here, although the understandability is very comparable, but there's still a little difference between the preference. The Indian accent is still preferred over the foreign accent. And this quantitative result coincides with our qualitative result, which means that when we conducted the participant interviews, users very explicitly stated that they would be very happy with an Indian accent over the foreign accent. Even though they could understand foreign accents, they had to strain a bit. So for us, it means the cognitive load was more when they were listening to a foreign accent. In fact, a few users guessed that there were a couple of American accents in the audio clips, and when we asked them, what would you prefer, American or Indian? So they were very clear, we would prefer to hear an Indian accent in an Indian voice technology over an American accent. And then the next part, so basically this first part of the study made it very clear that these users, they prefer Indian accents over foreign accents. Now when we wanted to study between Indian accents, like if you recall, we selected Hindi and Tamil. So we believe because of the very small sample, the results were not very clear. And this is what led us to the next study, which Gayatri will take you through. And yeah.
Is it on? For our second user study, we decided to focus only on Indian accents, and we had a couple of fresh hypotheses for this study. First, among Indian accents, do people prefer familiar ones or unfamiliar ones? And second, something we hadn't explored in our previous study, do people prefer mild Indian accents or heavy ones? So we also collected fresh voice recordings for this study because we had some issues with the CSLU data. For one thing, a lot of the accents were Americanized and we were not able to control the speaker's language backgrounds. So by recording our own fresh recordings, we were able to control for that. We had experts independently judge the thickness of the accent in our recordings, and we used these judgments to choose four speakers, mild Hindi accent, heavy Hindi accent, mild Tamil accent, and heavy Tamil accent. So we also had a fresh set of users for this study. This study we floated on Facebook, so we got 35 valid responses, which we think generally characterize a sample of people who use technology regularly, who are from urban areas and who communicate well in English. So we also had a small change to the experimental setup. Along with asking people for their understandability judgments on the accents, we also asked them to rate the thickness of each accent on a scale of 1 to 100. So let me show you what we saw from this study. For the first question, which was heavy accents or mild accents, we had we compared every heavy accent we had with every mild accent we had, so that gave us four questions. Let us see the understandability ratings on these. With the heavy accents on the left and the mild accents on the right, you can see that for every question, people did prefer, I mean, did find mild accents to be more understandable than heavy ones, significantly. And if we look at thickness, we can see that here also, people did find mild accents to be milder, they were able to judge. In three out of four cases, the difference in the thickness ratings were significant. And finally, when we come to preference, we can see we bent the preferences from being a strong preference for a heavy accent to a strong preference for a mild accent. And we see that in all cases, people were most likely to choose the mild accent very strongly. And second thing, familiar accents or unfamiliar accents. So for this, I'll show you results from one question where people had to compare mild Hindi accents to mild Tamil accents. And we had almost equal numbers of North Indian users and South Indian users. So we separated data like that. When you look at North Indian users' responses, you can see that most people had no preference between the accents, and you can't really say much on either side. Among South Indian users, there was a slight preference for Tamil accents, but not really too much to go on. So what these two surveys actually showed us was that people do prefer Indian accents, mild Indian accents, but are not very particular about which region in India the accents come from. However, both these surveys were conducted using sample audio clips. So maybe people's preferences change during a long conversation with a chatbot. And that is what we wanted to find out when we designed our third survey, where we wanted to see accent preferences when people are interacting with chatbots for extended durations. Now, the best way to conduct this kind of survey would be to have people actually interact with accented chatbots and then tell us what they thought. Unfortunately, this can be very difficult because it's difficult to synthesize good accented in English voices. And there are also many other components of a chatbot which might interfere with people's judgments. So we used a technique commonly used in HCI research, that is the Wizard of Oz technique. Here we would have a participant interacting with a chatbot, which is not actually a chatbot. It would just be a human wizard who would be playing canned responses based on what the participant says. So if we do this for, say, a mild Hindi accent and a mild Tamil accent, we can try to gauge people's preferences. So to design this study, we first chose two very comparable chatbot situations. One chatbot who would recommend a restaurant to you and one who would recommend a movie to you. We sketched very similar finite state machines for both chatbots, so that both would be reasonably the same level of interest, same level of interestingness, that the prompts that both chatbots gave would be very similar in terms of eliciting some set of long responses and short responses. And after this, we actually recorded the responses for the chatbots in a mild Hindi accent and a mild Tamil accent. The setup is also pretty easy. The participant basically just interacts with the wizard over Skype. And we did a few pilot studies to figure out whether the setup is okay. We fine-tuned it a little bit. But because we were short on time, we weren't actually able to conduct this survey at any small scale. And this is something of a longer-term initiative for us now, that we'll go ahead and conduct it and see what people think. So that's about it about the user studies. And I will now hand over to Sriram.
Just a quick question.
Yeah.
Did you ever classify your users as mildly accented or heavily accented?
No.
And I'm just thinking, maybe, I mean, if you define mild as something closer to you, then maybe a heavily accented person would prefer a heavy accent.
Definitely. Also, our users were all of a very similar profile in the sense that they were from urban places, they'd studied in English, and basically they would be our community on Facebook.
I would assume you would classify them as mildly accented if you were going to, and maybe that's why.
So if we did this with, and a lot of our users were between like 20, like we had a range, but many were between 20 and 30 years of age. So if we tried with older users or people from other backgrounds, we might definitely see stronger or different trends.
Could I ask a question?
Yes.
I have a hypothesis
yes.
that the greater exposure you have to an agent,
yes.
an agent's voice,
yes.
the better you might be in understanding what goes on.
Definitely.
So to some extent, you have to control for it, yes. or at least you need to measure that effect.
Yes, sir. Yes.
But you don't seem to have done any of that.
Yeah. So we had actually recorded, we had asked people how often they interact with voice agents. On, you know, every day, around once a month, barely ever. But we haven't actually correlated our findings with that yet. I think we should do that, right?
There is also another related possibility.
Yes.
That is the extent of listening to spoken English, the variety of voices one has heard, and the number of years for which one has been using spoken English and so on. That is bound to have an effect,
definitely,
right?
Yes, sir. Yeah. So
we did collect a lot of this language background information. So we tried, so this 35 users that we selected were somewhat homogeneous in terms of these variables that you just
like
mentioned.
People who had lived abroad.
So people, there were people who were born in India, then lived abroad for 8 years. So we excluded them from this study.
It appears to me that instead of doing the 90,000 hours or whatever Kalika recommends, it might be better to spend 90 hours training the user.
But you may have to train over 90,000 users.
Yeah, but it is his time.
So hi everyone. So what I will try to do in the next 10 minutes or so is trying to basically put together all the components that our team has been doing over the last month or so. So essentially, I would first focus on what is actually novel, what has been not been done so far that we could bring to the table because of this workshop. So first, about the accent identification, as Aditya already mentioned, this particular aspect of generally speech technology has not been well studied. We even had tough time finding out relevant papers and publications in this area, and it is only so as in the last couple of years that some amount of work has been, let's say, happening in this field. So our contribution particularly would be to explore the use of I vectors, as in these type of representations, which are trying to summarize your entire audio into a fixed dimensional representation. And we found that the I vectors do have some traction in identifying accents. And in particular, if we use models which are more like supervised models, like a DNN as a background model, we even improve upon the use of I vectors to predict the accents. And secondly, the aspect of the perhaps the most novel component in this is, how does you know your accented speech relate to the native language speech? Even though this has been, let us say, hypothesized in the past, we were particularly trying to see whether the representations like I vectors have this embedded in them, that the language embeddings and the accent embeddings have some similarity that you can learn from each other. So this particular aspect where we were trying to see whether you can map your accented, let's say, representation and your native language representation, how strong a connection you can build, that is perhaps one of the most novel component that we could come up with for accent identification.
I have a question here. When you were talking about this, you talked about the accuracy rates that you got.
Yes.
It looked somewhat low. Is that really state of art? I mean, or did you restrict in some sense your utterance size or if you increased?
So, to be very honest, there is actually nothing like a state of the art in this field because the field itself is very nascent. But what my personal experience in language recognition and all the past work is that the numbers seem to be reasonable because accent is a much milder effect on a voice data. And the other, factor that induced in our to reduce the performance is the duration. Like we had only 10 to 20 seconds to basically predict the accent. So we believe that if you provide a minute or beyond, then you may basically be able to predict the accent a lot easily. And last but not least, we had also in the user study, like we asked users, can you tell whether it is Hindi, Tamil, even between a binary class, users had a tough time, especially when it is milder accents. On heavy accents, the algorithm actually performs more than 75 to 80% accurately. So on the milder part of the accents, we saw that the, both the algorithm as well as the humans have trouble in predicting the accents.
It was a 10-class problem, and we didn't control for kind of the geographical regions from where those accents came. So Aditya had pulled up this confusion matrix. So there's some accents which are, you know, very, very close to each other. And so those were the ones which were mainly contributing to that low number. And which is why the top two and top three immediately pushed those numbers to 70 and 80%.
Just out of curiosity, how many Indian accents are there?
Two.
In so this study, only two Indian accents.
In the study, only two.
Only.
In general,
as many, you could probably say as many languages are there, and that question is also open. The official records say 130, but unofficially there is suggestions that more than 1300 languages are there, both some of them which have a written form, some of them which don't have any orthography, but still you know, widely spoken in that region or area. So it actually, the number of languages is a huge thing. Particularly, that's one of the reasons why your comment previously about collecting data is simply not possible in an Indian scenario to collect data, and also many of them require languages which have a written form. So the next, let us say, even to identify accents on languages when there is no written form, identify speech of when there is no written form, those are, let's say, very unique to our Indian context and maybe very relevant as well in terms of research. So, and one more thing about the accents in particular, not just for the voice bots and also for the ASR, the accent identification as a problem is also important for the surveillance community. People really want to basically take your 10 minutes of telephone conversation and say where you came from or which part of India or rest of the world you came from. So I have another project back in my home institution also trying to do speaker profiling. One of the sub problems is to identify accents. You mean modify the accent?
I mean, if I want to hold back my personal information, or for one Indian call center that's work in the US, for example, I just want to subtract out the accents, so it sounds nice and happy.
I haven't come up any work yet, but it's a kind of good suggestion though. See, the adaptation part, essentially, this cartoon pretty much summarizes it, that we want the speech recognition system to actually respond to and also recognize what I am speaking in my accent. So how I wish something like this existed in the call center in US when I was living there, that I used to call up and say my name 10 times and still they had trouble understanding my name. So the speech recognition systems as such, we need to focus on trying to make a model which can take your original accent and have a mild amount of accented data and be able to generalize to newer accents. So what we tried as particularly novel was to try a full adaptation, meaning throw everything in and then retrain the entire model. And a much more, let's say, nimble and efficient manner is to have only sensitive components, or more specifically the last few layers of the network which are going to be useful in your recognition to adapt to the accented data. And turns out that that indeed gives the best performance as well. And last but not least, among the user study, so that also tries to basically like link like what users prefer. I mean, at the end of it, we want to like to ask researchy questions, but also want to transform the existing products to make it to the next generation of products. So we found that as users, as Indian users in particular, we have a preference to be engaging with Indian accented speech bots. And that came out quite well in the studies that we did. And of course, if you ask an Indian user which regional accent he prefers, that answer is a lot more harder and vague to analyze. But we still we believe that there is some native regional preference, especially when we move out of the survey to be done in Bangalore or other metropolitan cities to, let's say, second tier and semi-urban areas. So that is pretty much in the three components that we had. And over the last week, we as a team already started asking questions like what we would do beyond this 1 month. So we have this time and effort spent, but what is it that we started with and what can go beyond? And turns out that there is a large possibility to explore in various directions that we started. For example, if the identification part alone, how does it integrate with speech recognition? What if I say the accent, give a wrong answer from the accent identification and it feeds into a speech recognition system or a text-to-speech system where a bot is basically trying to pronounce an accent? And the other aspects about how the strength of the accent and how long the duration of the accented speech is required to reliably predict, you know, the accent. This also connects to the question that was asked. We actually need some data to be specific about the Indian context to take this beyond, and some of the projects I'm involved in has some data collection components which I believe can also help in this domain. The adaptation part also, we would like to borrow similar ideas which work for identification, mainly like, can I use my native language speech to also adapt my acoustic models? Can I make the acoustic models for speech recognition aware of the phonemes that are present in my native language, and will that improve the speech recognition system? So can I make multilingual neural networks or acoustic models and then use them to do the accent adaptation for speech recognition? And the second aspect, which none of the project currently basically addressed, is there are other components in the ASR, as Abhinav was showing, which is the language model, the type of words that people use when they come from a particular region or accent. We haven't totally touched any of those. And the pronunciation models, we may constantly be pronouncing a word in a particular set of ways that is quite different from an American speaker. So we would like to introduce language models as well as pronunciation models that are accent specific, and maybe that is going to give us the next big jump in accent adaptation. And the preference, of course, as I mentioned already, we need to move beyond the metropolitan areas because that is the next generation of technologies where they have to go. We want to advance it to basically to the second tier cities, to campuses and other places in semi-urban areas so that the technology can basically be exposed to different accents, different user preferences, and so on. And last but not least, of course, the last part of user study, which Gayatri was trying to say, as in, make the studies more conversational so that you get more behavioral signals out of it, not just the preference as a single slider. You get a lot more by analyzing the behavior of listeners and users interacting with the conversational systems. And why is it all important? Because pretty much this slide, a survey that came out 2 months ago, sums up what is the future of voice market. So in 2016, for example, voice assistants, primarily Amazon Alexa has been the dominant component. About 1.8 million of these devices were sold, and pretty much all of it in the United States. Come to 2017, the trends are slowly changing, and the forecast for 2020 seems more and more like the technology is going to grow in leaps and bounds in terms of devices used, and a lot of contribution is going to come from places outside the United States. So the 61% or 39% of the rest of this number of assistants are going to be from places like India and China, where already another study which already says that among the voice data that is generated, 50 to 60% is generated in Asia. So we need technologies to focus on our accents and our data a lot more in the next few years than has what has happened in the last 5 years or so. And what the work has led to in terms of publications, we are already in the process of preparing an abstract. A deadline for our workshop is already fast approaching, which is next week. Then we have a transactions paper already in the pipeline, then a couple of other conferences later this year. So before I end, I would also like to emphasize that most of the codes and scripts written, most of the presentations that we made, documentations, all of them will be online in GitHub, and it will happen to, let's say, encourage reproducible research. And of course, we would like to gratefully acknowledge Microsoft Research Bangalore for providing this opportunity, as well as, in particular, Kalika and Monojit and Sunaina for their engaging discussions and their participation in the user studies. Plus, of course, the anonymous users in various places in India who contributed to our study through Facebook. So we do have, before I end, we do have a demo of how the technology works. So I will let Preeti take over that part.
Sorry, we have 3 laptops here so that we can do this demo.
Okay.
30 seconds.
Okay, so just to quickly introduce what the demo is doing, it's a like a first cut of integrating the accent identification work that we did over the workshop and the accent recognition. So currently it can load a pre-recorded sample. So here we have a bunch of utterances both in the Hindi and the Tamil accents. So Aditya is currently choosing, you can choose any clip. So once you choose a clip and you upload the file, so first it identifies what the...
Hi, my name is Srikant.
Yeah.
I am 24 years old.
So this is
I live in the Bay Area, in San Francisco Bay Area in California. And I've been living in the U.S. for the last 4 years. And I like this place. The weather here is great.
Okay, so any guesses on what the underlying accent could be? So this is, it's a binary task, so it's either Hindi or Tamil. So it's a little anglicized, but any guesses on Tamil? Tamil, Tamil. Okay, it is most of you are saying Tamil. So we're still decoding the speech utterance. The ASR system is currently working. So I just want to point out, even decoding a single utterance takes this long.
Which Google and
which,
Alexa
yeah.
does it on the massive servers,
which Aditya
is trying to do it on his laptop.
So that's the differential between the existing, yeah.
It's just, we'll take
a yeah, it'll just take a few more seconds, so kindly bear with us. Sorry, Monojit. Yeah, so here in red is the baseline system prediction. And green are our improved models. So both on the accent identification task and on the accent recognition task. So you can see that the baseline prediction was Tamil, as most of you predicted, but it actually turns out to be wrong. It's a Hindi accented speech sample. So this probably answers your question as to why that problem was so hard. And the baseline word error rate is around 44.4%, and that almost gets cut down into half. So here you can see the reference of the underlying speech sample that we just heard. If you can go, further down.
Down.
Yeah, so we have the baseline decoded statement and then our newly adapted system. So you can see that, so things like Shrikant, these are out of vocabulary words and we really can't expect to recover those accurately. But otherwise, many of these errors are mitigated. Okay, so thanks a lot. We can take, if,
take
please, yeah, please feel free yourselves.
We're open to take more questions if Monojit allows.
If Monojit allows, yes.
You have like 7 minutes.
Okay.
So I had one question. If the input speech consists of multiple languages, then
yes.
How do you handle that case?
Right. One set of
is
approaches.
Of diarization, meaning that you take an online decision. Right now, nothing that has not been done here. So what diarization means is you could also have a conversation where there are multiple speakers, or there are a speaker having, let us say, speaking in multiple languages in the same recording. So what you do in those cases, you fix a window, and then you run that window across and try to do language identification along that window.
And this is a very hard task. So this actually ties up with the work Sunayana and others are doing at MSR. So even code switching, essentially is this where you're switching between multiple languages within the same utterance. It's a very difficult problem. So even this kind of windowing, the state of the art is also something which can be significantly improved.
Because every language may have its own accent, right?
Its
own different accents.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
So I think with this, so the underlying language is the same. So it's English throughout. And we're just working with these varying accents, and that in itself is so challenging. Without even including a different code, like a different language. This was very interesting for us while we were working on this project.
Just since we have time, just curious what the theoretical understanding of the difference between an accented language and a different language. I mean, they say Indian English and Chilean Spanish as if they're different languages. Is it just the population size? There's so many people that speak it, so it's almost a language, or is it grammatical structure, or is it just how you pronounce things? Yeah, I mean,
yeah.
If there's other questions, we can.
Can I throw
to.
This question to Kalika? Yeah. So I'm not sure about what the technical definition is, and I'm not even sure if one exists. Sakshi is a linguist, so actually didn't do a good job in today's. Yes, please.
So Indian English.
Sakshi, you can. You can use this.
So, Indian English has been called a sub-variety of English also in literature, and it definitely is a language in its own. It has a different structure from the British or the American English. It has a different phoneme set. So, yeah, it is different. Like, and was this your question? Does this answer?
No one would ever say, French English as a language. Mm-hmm. They would say it's English with a French accent, but yeah. They do say Chilean Spanish, for example, mm-hmm. or Indian English or Jamaican English. I mean, Irish I understand because it's fundamentally a language, but if it's...
I think it's got to do with whether it is used, there is a speech community around it, if it's used at a societal level or not. It's considered a dialect, and then you consider what is a dialect, then a dialect is... Not French English, but Canadian French, for example, is a variety of French.
I mean, the only reason I ask in this context is if it's a completely different language, then you would say you need a larger body of data. No one would, you wouldn't try to adapt certain languages. So, yes. But in this, you're obviously, you don't want to do that. So
yes.
When is it applicable? When is it not?
Indian English is definitely a different variety.
Yeah.
Or a
I would say, yeah, it's a language
Indian
answer.
English, how do you define Indian English?
Yeah. And so today it's not just the second language of most Indians. There's a part of, there is some community for those people, it's actually the first language. Like, I have friends who are half Malayali, half Bengali, but they've mostly heard and spoken English since birth. So for them, it's very difficult to decide if their language is Bengali or Malayalam or English. I mean, they do not hesitate in saying, oh, my first language is English, Indian English. Yeah. So I would say it's pretty much a language on its own. Yeah, the syntax
so think,
is so different.
Maybe one way maybe to analyze it would be to look at the overlap in the vocabulary of Indian English versus American English, say. And of course, there will be a difference, but maybe there is a threshold where, you know, that difference is significant enough that now it's a different language. And if it's below the threshold, maybe we can count it as accented English. It's just a hypothesis. I'm not sure.
Just from like a business perspective, calling it a different language seems like that's a better way to get more resources around
yes.
it.
Yeah.
I mean, if it's an accent, it's like, well, fix your accent.
Yeah, yeah,
if it's a different
yeah.
language, then you can't
yeah.
see that, right?
So that's exactly, that's precisely what we are against. So we don't want to fix the accent.
Yeah.
You should be able to use your organic accent and interact with the device. You shouldn't have to sound synthetic or sound more like a
yeah.
more Americanized or whatever,
yeah.
whatever works well. Yeah, that's the kind of high level goal.
Yeah. Any other questions?
I think I have one. Why did the speaker have to say, I am Srikant in this experiment?
The speaker
comes and says, I am Srikant. That misleads everybody into thinking he's more likely to be Tamilian.
That's true. Basically, the system doesn't know that.
It's,
so the system is unbiased.
Chose to
yes,
show us
yes.
and to confuse us.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
No, actually, it wasn't. Yeah,
you can
pick. I was surprised.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can choose any accent from the terms.
Basically, you could have guessed from the file name.
We had better ones. We had better ones. Actually, could have.
Yeah.
Should we?
Okay. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.